Good day and welcome to the next in our series of Wisecast webinars under the EMI initiative. So EMI, as you know, talks about the economy, the stock markets and the investment allocations. And today we are going to focus on sectors. What do we mean by sectors? Well, sectors are in the stock market, are in the economy. And obviously, when we talk about the stock market performance, the economic performance, how it translates into earnings of the companies in the sectors is what we are going to evaluate today. So why do we want to look at sectors at all? It's because fund managers across, whether they are from the mutual fund industry or from FIIs or from companies or insurance companies, they all study and buy sectors before they study and buy stocks. So that's the primary thing. It's called a top-down approach where you understand the economy, then look at the industries and sectors in the economy, and then choose the good quality stocks. So this forms the core of a fund performance in the country. And hence, let's start off by looking at how the sectoral performance has been in the stock market. So this is data as of day before yesterday. And as you can see, I've listed out, if you can count, there are 13 sectors here. I've given the closing values of these sectoral indices. Right, these are all the Bombay Stock Exchange indices, barring one or two. And I've given the 1 month return, 3 months return, 6 months returns, 1 year returns, and 3 year returns of these indices. So as you can see, right, the top appears to be green and the bottom appears to be red. So the green is a positive return and the red is a negative return. So clearly there is a sharp polarization, as you can see. In fact, there is polarization across the sectors, polarization within across time frames. For example, if you look at the BFSI sector, right, the 1 month to 6 month returns are positive, but the 1 year and 3 year are negative. Whereas if you look at even the 1 month returns, the BFSI is positive, and then when you go down to the cyclical and industrial sectors, they are negative. So what is the reason that you have a mixed performance for sectors? What is the logic behind that? And should you be investing in sectoral funds? If so, what allocation is what I'm going to try to cover today. So one of the ways to look at the different performances is that we are going to look at the quarterly earnings that were reported for the last quarter. You're going to look at the economic trends that's happening in those sectors. So it's useful to remember what's been happening. So in this slide, I've compared two sets of data. One is 1 year returns and one is 3 year returns. And I've chosen 3 points for exactly the same sectors that you saw there. What are the 3 points in time? I've chosen December 31, 2019. March 2020 and October 15, which is a couple of days ago. What is the reason for this? I wanted to show you the impact of the COVID crisis on sectoral industry performances and post-COVID, how the recovery has been. So if you look at the one-year returns chart, for example, in December, you saw that there were about four or five sectors in green on one-year returns and the rest were in red. But when it came to March, everything turned into red. Every single sector in the stock market, because of the COVID crisis and the impact on the stock market in the month of March, went into deep red. And then you've seen a recovery. Now you can see there's still a mix of green and red as of the 1 year. But the point I wanted to stress, and that's where I will come to the next slide, the same situation is prevalent in the 3 year returns. What is the point I want to make is that though there is a mix of red and green, both in December and October, what you do is if you take a delta, if you take the difference, right? The difference between December and March was a correction, and the difference between March and October is a recovery. So though there are sectors which are today also giving you negative returns on 1 year, you can see that those are much less negative than they were in March, which is the difference between the two is what is the V-shaped recovery. You can see almost every sector in the stock market has experienced a V-shaped recovery after the COVID crisis, right? And then I've given a ranking on the right-hand side. As you see, there are 13 ranks there. So the top three sectors, that is those which have bounced back the most, are 1, 2, and 3, as you can see, IT, tech, and healthcare. Whereas if you see the worst performing in terms of the recovery, right? They've all recovered. The worst performing in terms of recovery are 11, 12, and 13, which is your oil and gas sector, your consumer durable sector, and your FMCG sector, the consumption space. So broadly, this gives you a sense as where has the sectoral recovery been fastest and where has it been slowest, noting that everywhere there has been a recovery. Now to understand this from a why this has happened in this particular way, why all the sectors have not gone up equally, and also understanding how then you should look at your investment allocation, we shall now deep dive into the economic situation. And I'd like to headline this by saying that this all the sectors recovery, but the Reserve Bank governor says that the stock market performance is disconnected with the economic situation. Is that right? If it's right, how right is it? And what do we read into this, right? Because on the hand you have a recovery, on the other hand you have an economic situation which is clearly, as per the American governor, at divergence. Let us now study that. So coming to an update on India's economic outlook, right? First things first, this graph starts from quarter one 2017 and ends just before the COVID crisis, that is quarter four of 2020. The reason I'm putting this up is that to show you that the Indian economy has been on a slowdown, whether you take services, industry and agriculture all put together, the three sectors of the economy have been on a declining trend right from quarter four of 2018. So to put it precisely, from December 2017. So the Indian economy was already in a slowdown. So that's a point to be noted. Then we come to the impact of the COVID. And when COVID crisis hit, it is a medical crisis of contagion. And so a lockdown was the only solution available to the governments to tackle this across the world, since there was no vaccine or cure available then. So here you see, rest of the world has adopted severity of lockdown ranging from very high to moderate. But India, in the middle of this graph, you can see, we were that country which went to the most severest lockdown of rank 10 for 4 weeks. Then we came to 8, and then we gradually started unlocking the country. So the reason I point out this is that on top of an already slowing economy, the COVID crisis came and hurt our economy, but the lockdown also came and hurt our economy, because when you prevent people from traveling, they can't spend, they can't consume, demand got affected. So our country has had three negative impacts. First, a longer term slowdown caused by the NBFC crisis and a lot of other things. Second was the COVID crisis. Third was the lockdown, our response being the most severest. So what it achieved though was that it helped us to contain the contagion within the urban areas of the country, so that rural India could get back into business, right? So if you look at the now the economic path, this please keep it in mind. And hence, across the world, the impact of COVID and lockdowns led to massive GDP declines. And as you can see, I've taken the data for the first quarter of this financial year. You can see double-digit negative, except China, which had already passed this phase 3 months before because they had the crisis quite some time before the rest of the world. They've come back to positive, but India is among the worst hit of the world's GDPs, right? And within India, if you look at the sectoral breakup, then we look at something called gross value added, GVA, which is also down at 23%. Industries was badly hit at 38%. Services badly hit at 39%. But as I said, we protected rural India from the initial contagion, and hence agriculture posted a positive growth of 3.5%. Right. So now you come back and look at it in terms of the sectoral performances. I've chosen here the NSE 500, which has about 20-25 sectors. The reason I tell you is that when we discuss, obviously we can't be discussing all the sectors in the economy. We look at those that make an impact on the stock market, because we are essentially going to discuss from that angle and perspective. So what I've done here is the indices in the NSE 500, I've sorted them in descending order of weight in the index. So when you see a stock market performance, a heavyweight sector, right, will naturally have a greater impact on the returns that you get on the overall market. So I've listed here. So as you can see, private banks are the number one in terms of weight, which accounting for 17.8% of the NSE 500, which is a very broad market index. Then comes information technology with 11.8%. Then fast moving consumer goods at 11.5%. Then you have oil and gas at 10%. NBFC is at 9.5, automobile at 5, and pharma at 5. So just 7 sectors account for 70% of the weight of the index. So if you study these 7 sectors, you should get a fair bit of clue as to why the stock market is behaving the way it is, because these drive the market. So our discussion will essentially be centered around these 7 sectors. Number 1. Number two, so I've shown the 1 year returns as of March. You recollect some time back we had discussed that. So 1 year returns were negative for all of these sectors. Then we come to last month end in September 2020. In September 2020, those 1 year returns, you can see that only in two, that is in private banks and in NBFCs, have those sectoral indices continued to remain negative. In all the other heavyweight sectoral indices in the NSE 500 have posted positive 1 year return. So one of the reasons why the stock market is doing well overall is because the heavyweight sectors have all delivered very good performance in terms of the 1 year return, right? And you take a call on what is the 1 month return as of September, because then you can know recently what is the sector which is being favored by the fund managers who are buying there. You can see that the same pattern, the 1 year repeats there, except that in FMCG was marginally positive in September 30th, but it's marginally negative in the 1 month return as of September 30th. So clearly, FMCG, there is a slowdown in terms of buying by fund managers in addition to the other two, right? So now let us dive deep, as I promised at the beginning of this, into these sectors from an economy, from an earnings of the companies in this sector, and the, how the stock prices have moved, right? So let's look at now. So what I said, that now I will look at the sectoral stock market performance versus the sectoral economy performance, and then follow it up with the sectoral quarter one and earnings. So all three we'll look at together to understand whether the RBI governor's statement, was it true? Is it true that there is a disconnect between the economic performance, the earnings performance, and the stock market's performance? So let's start with the first heavyweight, which is the BFSI, which is the banking, financial services, and insurance, right, overall. So here, if you look at it from an economy perspective, let's remember that Reserve Bank took a lot of steps to support the government's actions. They pumped in about 8 lakh crores of liquidity. They cut interest rates by 115 basis points. Plus, they gave in moratoriums and subsidized credit, and they cut the reverse repo rates. They did a lot of stuff to support. So the Reserve Bank's actions are essentially driven through the banking system. So the banking system was the first beneficiary of both of the rate cuts and of the liquidity pumping. And in the rate cuts from a banking sector, you can see that the repo rate was cut by 115 basis points, but the bankers have cut the lending rate to on existing loans only by 23 basis points. So 90 basis points of the rate cut, which was eligible to them on their existing book, was not passed on and kept. So naturally, their profitability should have improved. On fresh loans, they did pass on 72 basis points, as you can see. So that is the gap that there is still there in terms of fresh loans. So here again, they have retained 40 basis points as their additional profits. Plus, they have also cut rates on term deposits. So when the Reserve Bank cut rates there, they've also passed on that rate cut by 33 basis points on term deposits. And if you see, the other benchmarks are also gone down in various. So net net, as a summary, the transmission of the policy rate is only partial, hence banks' net interest margins should have improved, right? Now, the other thing was that the worry of the NPA is there, right? So that, because of the moratorium, instead of giving the third extension to the moratorium, RBI came with a resolution framework, essentially targeting at easing the borrower's debt burden, right? So what they did, Mr. Kamath, who headed the committee which did that, came back, and with their framework, 66% of rated companies are going to benefit from a restructuring, right? Depending on their credit quality, the amount of companies that benefit varies, and the industries which are likely to be benefit are construction, real estate, and chemicals. But remember, we are discussing the banking sector. So what is going to help the banking sector is that potential NPAs are now going to become standard assets, because they will restructure the loans and give them additional time to pay. So this is, in the end, while it's positive for the recipient companies, it's also positive for the banks, right? And so in this period, I've taken a longer term data to show you the trend, is that bank deposit growth has by and large gone, except for a small deceleration because they cut the deposit rates recently. Otherwise, the trend right from the beginning of the calendar year has been of a rise in deposit growth, which is good news for banks, right? Next, but their lending has come down sharply. So not only did they not pass on the rate cuts, they also have dramatically been cutting down their lending to industry, to services sector, and overall non-food credit growth, right? Food credit growth is through the Food Corporation of India and all of that, the stocks there. Apart from that, you see credit has been on a declining trend. Loans to NBFCs have also been declining in this period, and hence, by this prudent management of this, by not making extra loans, and they have been making money, you can see that the banks, whether they are large cap, mid cap, small cap, micro cap, so all the banks in the stock market, the quarter one, their sales performance has been good, which means their top line has grown, their operating profit has expanded dramatically, their profit after tax has also expanded, and the margins, except for the very top end, because you know top borrowers have obviously squeezed down the banks because liquidity is surplus, they're getting cheap money. For the rest of the market, they have been able to expand their margins. So bank sectoral performance in terms of earnings has been good. And the same is true of the financial services companies, where NBFCs largely feature. If you see here, in the large and the mid cap, they've had a good sales, operating profit, PAT change. But the smaller NBFCs and all other ones which have suffered, right? So overall, then, if you now look at the earnings for PSU banks, private banks, NBFC and financial services, you can see that from March to September, Delta, they have all shown an improvement. Though, as of 1 year, returns today are negative, except for the financial services space. NBFCs are negative, but if you take the 1 month return, there is a negative trend there. So clearly the concerns, despite having very good profits, the concerns have made sure that 1 month returns are not very strong. So a much more updated, that 1 month is on September 20th. If you go down to the table below, as of October 15th, the 1 month return has improved because the Common Committee's recommendation and all has thrown a new light to the banking sector. So you can see the situation improving there. So 1 year return still continues to be negative. 1 month and 3 month and 6 month returns have all turned positive. So the outlook on the banking sector is turning positive on the back of good earnings and the Commerce Committee's recommendations reflecting a good future. Now we'll move to another heavyweight there. So banking, I hope I have explained to you. Information technology, IT sector. Now the IT sector, remember, is more connected to the world than to the domestic economy. So we can't take a judgment call on the IT sector until you look at what's happening in the world. And in the world, as you know, economic response was three-pronged, a rate cut action strongly, a monetary stimulus of pumping money, and a fiscal stimulus of supporting corporates in terms of jobs and other things. Right? So you see weighted average policy rates have sharply dropped here. You can see that trend. You can also see that the note printing, the expansion of the balance sheet of the top four countries has been dramatic compared to the previous crisis. And you had all the top countries expanding their fiscal deficit, which means the government fiscal stimulus has been tremendously expanded. US fiscal deficit, in fact, is set to touch 19% of GDP. Right? So essentially in the world, there is a strong expectation of a V-shaped recovery versus the U-shape of the previous crisis, because there is a hope that in addition to those efforts, the infection containment through lockdowns will also come through, and in about a year's time, a vaccine or a cure is expected to be in place. Right? Hence, based on this, the post-COVID world, if you look at it, the IMF expects that the world will post a sharp recovery. China will lead the way, followed by overall world. Within the overall world, you'll find emerging countries are going to react faster than the developed world. Right? So these are the data that the IMF published. And another thing to support this recovery is the fact that the Baltic Dry Index, which is inter-country trade, if you see, pre-COVID crisis was at 1090 level, dropped by 40% because of the COVID crisis, naturally trade was collapsing. But since then, it has almost tripled in value, which is again a strong signal of a V-shaped recovery, because manufacturing and then the traded goods, the ships are getting blocked and booked for future shipping of heavyweight items, right? So naturally, from a tech perspective, this crisis, right, has proved to be a wonderful, maybe another Y2K moment for the tech industry. And if you see, even within the US stock market, the tech heavy NASDAQ has grown at almost double the V-shaped recovery of the broader market. So tech is clearly a beneficiary of the recovering world when corporates are using the situation because of the COVID and the pandemic to restructure their technological operations, because now work from home has become of more of a norm. Internet is being used heavily, so Internet of Things, huge. Cloud computing and making it available wherever employees can work is key. So IT companies which have quickly moved on to grab this opportunity obviously have a very good future, and hence that is reflected if you look at the quarter one results of the IT sector. Large cap, mid cap, small cap, right, barring a few, has strong sales growth, strong operating profit growth, and profit after tax growth. So the IT sector has doing well, both on the basis of this existing earnings and an expected future, which is looking bright because the world outside is coming back faster to a V-shaped recovery. And hence, if you look at the index, the delta between the one-year returns is 45%. That is, in March, it was down 17%. Now, 30th September, it is up 28%. And even the last 1 month returns have been 11%. And if you take most recent data, it tells you that 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, right up to 3 years, the IT and the tech indices are all in green territory. So one of the key things here to remember is that despite the Indian economy slowing down, the IT sector is doing well in terms of current earnings and future expected earnings because of a fast recovering world. So to the extent it explains to Mr. Das's statement that the market is disconnected, because one key segment of the market is not connected with the domestic economy but has eyes on the world economy. Right? Next, a big sector like this is the healthcare sector. The reason I point out the healthcare sector is because if you look at the earnings there, healthcare sector's earnings are obviously doing well. Why? Because COVID has become a time when people are more sensitive, but the current earnings, healthcare includes not just pharmaceutical companies, but includes hospitals, includes diagnostic companies, and all of them have seen a boom in their business, reflecting very, very clearly in terms of the operating profits. So naturally, the healthcare sector, right, which was also the negative in March, 1 year, 10 and a half, today is 1 year is 65 positive, which means the delta is 76%. Is the change in the one-year return, and even the 1 month continues to be positive. If you take the more recent October 15th update, right, from 1 month to 3 years, it is in green territory. What is the reason for this? One is demand for healthcare services has gone up because of COVID, but more importantly, in the future, regardless of where in the world a COVID vaccine or a cure is discovered, manufacturing it in bulk will have to rely on Indian pharma, because over the years we have built up a massive capacity in terms of generic bulk drug manufacturing. So a lot of Indian pharma companies are expected to benefit from this order book, regardless of where in the world the discovery is actually made and patented. So Indian pharma's outlook is turned very positive. And the pharma index obviously has done very well. And this again is another answer to what Mr. Das stated, that is the disconnect. Here the disconnect is because the pharma sector in a depressed economy has also been having a decent economic performance. Plus, it is also an outward looking sector, which is depending on the world at large to buy its products. And hence, its stock market performance is not so correlated with the Indian economic performance, but rather with the recovering world. So this is the second one which explains the disconnect in the market. Now we come to look at the other sector, which is the heavyweight, which is the consumption. Consumption has two parts to it. Fast-moving consumer goods, which is your soap, shampoos, your daily use products, frequently used products. And consumer discretionary, which is at the higher end, your washing machines, refrigerators. It's also called by the word consumer durables, right? So these are the two aspects. What's the difference between the two? Fast-moving consumers are low-value items. So they're essentially something which are providing a safety, because you can't be without your hair oil or you can't be without your soap regardless of the recession. Whereas discretionary means that there is a choice that you either go and buy it or don't buy it. And so your outlook, your disposable income, all of those play a part. Interest rates, all of them play a part. So looking at these sectors, right? First, let's look at the fact on money in the economy. Central government's plan, revenue expenditure. Central government has a plan. So in the plan they spend, the revenue expenditure actually puts money in circulation in people's hands, and that boosts consumption. So that you can see the revenue expenditure clearly recently has declined. Next, but though the revenue plan expenditure and real government consumption has been growing at double digit percentage. So that's the good news. But private consumption has been at a low single digit for quite a few quarters, and this quarter saw a sharp 27% drop. right? And urban consumption, if you look at it across various variables that I've shown here, is showing signs of a gradual V-shaped recovery, right? At the same time, if you look at the banking part, right, this is where banks have actually increased their lending. So you saw the good performance of the banks. That's because they have been much more comfortable in giving retail loans to consumers because they are at higher interest rates and they spread their risk, right? So if you look at credit card outstandings after sharp falling during the early stages, have now started rising as the unlock is happening. And personal credit, which slowed down dramatically, has also eased up now. So clearly, there is some lending boost happening to this sector. So however, because of the lockdown and the crisis, the first quarter was terrible for the consumer goods company. So if you look at it, whether sales, operating profit, profit over tax, or margin changes have all been negative across large, mid, small, and micro. So clearly, the domestic performance of these companies has not been very good. But the stock market, if you see the delta, you saw 50% and 40% deltas in IT, healthcare, not. Here you're seeing a delta of just 5%. In fact, the 1 month return has been slightly negative. So there is not really that much of a disconnect between the performance and the performance here. There is small improvement. And if you look at the 1 month to 3 month, you can see the reference CG 1 month and 3 month is negative. As of October 15, then 1 year is also negative. So here again, the market's performance is, while it's should not as negative as the earnings is showing, indicates that the market is expecting some kind of a revival in consumer purchasing during Diwali and the festival season. And that's what is at play here. But overall, compared to the growth in the IT and the pharma sectors, this is nothing great. And hence, I would say that to that extent, there is not a great disconnect between the performance of the earnings related to the economic performance of that sector and the stock market's performance, right? Within the consumer, there's another sector called the auto sector, which is also a heavyweight in the index. So automobiles, you see, commercial vehicle has been a deep slowdown, continues to be so, very small uptake. Medium and heavy commercial vehicles, same story. Light commercial vehicles, same story. So clearly, the traded freight movement has not been supportive of additional production of these vehicles, which means the existing capacity of medium and heavy commercial and light commercial vehicles is adequate, so no new production is happening. So that's a negative part in the economy. And however, on the sales side, wholesale and retail passenger vehicle sales, right, have been rising. So clearly, passenger vehicle segment, the trucking segment is not growing, but passenger vehicles is showing a sharp shape recovery. Tractor sales on the back of agriculture, which I'll cover in a little bit now, have remained very strong. You can see that the sharp uptake, right? Why is this? If you recollect, agriculture was that sector which, even in a deep negative quarter, posted a 3.4% positive GDP growth, right? And hence, if you look at the range of vehicles and compare over last year, YOY, two-wheelers are about 70% of last year's registrations, cars are at 95% of last year's registrations, tractors are at 184%. It's only the truck, buses, and three-wheeler which are not. So auto is a very polarized sector where two-wheeler cars and tractors are doing very well, and trucks and buses and three-wheelers are not doing so well, right? So naturally, if you see vehicle loans, because vehicle loans are given for tractors and for buying private vehicles, have seen a small uptick recently. And parts and transport equipment loans, right? Those also, if you see, have seen a sharp V-shaped recovery. And but despite all of this pockets of recovery, the auto sector companies' earnings are very, very bad shape because the kind of capacity they created cyclically, even this growth that's happening has not changed the fortunes of this. But if you go to the stock market, there is a sharp divergence. So this is one case where clearly what the Reserve Bank governor said is apparent, that the performance of the sector, the performance of the earnings of the companies in that sector is at divergence with what is happening in the stock market. There's been a 50% bounce back. And in fact, more recently, if you see, 1 month to 1 year is positive, only 3 years is negative. So what could be the reason for this? One is that with Diwali, they expect this trend to shoot up. So market participants are saying that though commercial vehicles and three-wheelers are not yet showing that kind of growth, the rest of the auto sector is showing a growth. Hence, they are optimistic that the Diwali will turn out to be very good. Second aspect here is that last year, this auto has been in a slowdown for more than 2 years now. Ever since GST was implemented, the trucking segment has been facing a challenge in terms of the fact that if they don't have that much time, it doesn't take to go from Chennai to Delhi and back. Because of GST coming in, now it's very fast transit. So existing vehicles are able to service more freight. So that bad is continuing for commercial vehicles, but the rest of the auto sector, because last year was very bad, this year's growth on a YOY will look very good in earnings. So market, based on the fact that you have bad base effect of last year and the fact that Diwali could prove a boost, are betting on this sector, ignoring the current performance of this. So this is where the governor got it right to say that the stock market is disconnected from the economic reality. Right. Now, I spoke to you about tractors and why they're bombing. So clearly, agriculture showed a 3.5% growth. So I think we need to look at the agri sector because it has its spillover effect on the consumption sector. So there, if you see, right, a combination of factors that farmers have money in their hand because the rabi crop harvest was very good. Second, the lockdown resulted in a lot of migrants going from urban to rural areas, hence labor supply was plentiful. Third, the monsoon also came down in time and hence gave a very positive thing to going and sowing the crop. So if you see now, week on week, kharif sowing area has gone up. It has reached more than 100% of the normal area sown. And in fact, it is at a high last reached in 2016. So clearly, the agriculture sector is on a good wicket. Also because the lockdown protected rural India from the contagion. So hence the outlook for the agri is good, and that's what is seen in the demand for fertilizers. So fertilizer production has shown a sharp V-shaped recovery, and hence if you look at the chemicals, pesticides, fertilizer sector, chemicals has been a mixed bag, but fertilizer and pesticides closely linked to rural have seen very strong growth in operating profit and profit after tax, and this spillover is what you saw in terms of demand for tractors and two-wheelers, right? Plus, the future outlook for agriculture is very good because of the recent reform passed by the government in terms of three agri-related bills, which have led to some political controversy, but are fundamental reforms which will give more freedom to farmers on price determination and will help improve price realization as well as productivity of Indian agriculture. So this is probably a watershed moment in Indian agriculture, and the future should turn out to be very good because of this reform. Right? So the chemical sector, which is where all these stocks feature, has shown a very strong delta of 62% in the 1 year returns. Right? So another sector which was very big there was the oil and gas sector. But as many of you are familiar, right, one of the main companies in the country, which is more than 10% of the index, is classified under oil and gas sector, but is actually also a retail and a telecom player. So the stock market performance is reflects that company's performance. So here, let's look at this sector on its own merits from the fact that crude price drop, while it was a blessing for the country in terms of $80 to $40, is not good news for the oil and gas sector, right? So from that point of view, crude production has been on a decline because lockdown demand has been coming down. But natural gas, because the shift to alternative energy and fuels has seen a revival there. And refinery products overall, which is thing, functioning naturally are in a decline. And coal production, because industrial activity is slowly picking up after a sharp drop, is showing a V-shaped recovery. Mining and quarrying loans to support coal and everything else also is showing a rising trend. Core electricity production from the coal is because of the electricity has gone up. That's the reason coal production went up. Okay. And if you see the trend of electricity consumption is showing a gradual V-shaped recovery. So overall, to summarize the status in terms of crude, oil, whatever we have seen, you can see that they are all in slightly red, but growing towards green in terms of the movement, which indicates a positive turnaround in the sector. But the performance of energy companies, while they've all managed to improve their margins, their profits are all down YOY. Right? And so the oil and gas sector's performance, as I mentioned sometime before, it looks very good, but it's disconnected with the reality of oil and gas because the main company here is not just oil and gas player, but also has a telecom and a retail play for which the market is taking its price up. So there's a disconnect between the sector's performance and the stock market performance, but which is explainable because of the reasons I just laid out, right? Now we come to the other sectors which are heavyweights, but which are a more futuristic outlook. And if you notice, in the very first slide, I showed you that the cyclicals and industrials are still showing a negative one-year return. So what is the reason for that? We should now look at that, right? Let's look at it from a perspective of the world, because industrials has a connect with the world. So manufacturing PMIs are recovering in the US and Europe and are following the trend set by China. The world is recovering. So the world is going to experience a much shorter manufacturing than was expected. In fact, 82% of countries have shown an improvement in their PMI, Purchase Manager Index, compared to the previous month. So IMF has also revised its global trade growth forecast by 80 basis points upward for the next year. So global manufacturing is on a revival path. And in India, so what happens is that steel, cement loans, construction loans, all are showing varying levels of reddish color in trend, which means that when you look at steel production, it's showing a V-shaped recovery. When you look at the metals performance, the performance has not been great because the demand has been down. So you can see sales, operating profit, profit after tax. Indian domestically has not been doing well, but the prices for ferrous metals and both are shown a sharp delta. So here again, the RBI governor was right that there's a disconnect between the economy and their performance and the stock market performance. The reason here is that the prices of metals are fixed at the London Metal Exchange. So a recovering world is taking those prices up. And though their numbers have not been great, their prices are going up. So their sales will go up. Though quantity doesn't go up, price into quantity makes up sales. Price is going up. So the market is betting on the metal sector, saying that world economic recovery will mean a positive price appreciation for the metals in the country. So that's what this is showing to you. Right? Now, when you look at the domestic factor, and metals is because it's a global cyclical. I treated that with the world at large. Now we come to India post-COVID. We know that Mahatma Binodal Bharat was a big thing done by the government. In October, the government topped up these measures with another 73,000 crores of fresh measures, another 0.5% of GDP. And they announced this kind of a stimulus of 6.5% of GDP without impacting the fiscal deficit much. And India is also expected to show a V-shaped recovery, as you know. And though this quarter was down 24, the next quarter is expected down only about 9. And then further thereafter, maybe come down to only low single digit. And in the last quarter, we expect a positive GDP growth to come into India on the basis of agricultural posting a strong, perhaps even double digit growth, because the kharif sowing has been excellent. And that harvest should come through in the last quarter of the year. So, basis that the central government, however, because of the constraints on the revenue expenditure that they have been trying, that the capital expenditure has been down. So, government buying on the industrial sector has been low. And the positivity comes for Indian manufacturing from the fact that compared to China, which has a declining labor population in red line, we have a rising labor population. So, we expect India to get market share from China, not only because of this, but because the people, 44% of the people say those who are factories in China, that they intend to relocate it outside of China, right? And these relocation intentions are wholesale in terms of setting up new production facilities, which is good for the industrial sector of India from a slightly longer term perspective. India has also made it more easy for these companies to come by cutting our tax rates by half. 35 to 17 at par with the best in the world, and our ease of doing business rankings have seen a sharp improvement, making us more attractive for a foreign manufacturer to look at setting up manufacturing in India. So FDI has been rising for India, so this augurs well that with all of these recent measures, you will see an even sharper flow of FDI into manufacturing. And hence, if you see domestically, cement production has seen a V-shaped recovery. Basic metal loans have been going up from the bankers. Cement loans, though, are decreasing because the companies there are obviously able to ramp up production without borrowing because they're sitting on excess capacity. And construction loans related to real estate are going up, right? Engineering loans, general industry is down, so those loans are not going up. Infra loans, after a sharp fall, are showing a rising trend slightly. And commercial real estate loans, however, banks are still wary of lending to commercial real estate, and that has been on a declining trend. So overall, the impact of this is that both the cement and the construction sectors have been showing a sharp decrease in sales, profits, and margins across the board. So the industrial sector clearly is not on a good wicket yet. And there is a some increase of delta in building materials and real estate, but not of the order of IT, pharma, and auto that you saw in 40, 50, 60%. But between 16 to 22% is the delta in terms of the rents. But the one-year returns are still negative for real estate and marginally profitable for the building materials segment, right? This gives you a summary of the economic data that we just spoke about. And manufacturing PMI, however, has started showing a bounce back to going back above 50, which is good news. And the manufacturing of the industrial production index is also showing a V-shaped recovery. Poor electricity is also on the back of increasing activity going up. But the overall manufacturing sector, right, still is not reflected a very healthy picture in the quarter one. So you can see it's red right across sales, operating profit, PAT, and change in margins, right? So the capital goods sector hence continues to have a one-year double-digit negative return infrastructure, though there is an improvement of 20% from the deep negative of March to now, right? So that's the summary that's telling you about the fact that the industrial sector at the ground level is showing nascent signs of recovery, but the indices are yet to fully participate in that at this point in time till the market gets a better outlook for the future. We finally come to the, we covered the agricultural sector, we covered the industrial sector. Now we will talk about the services sector, which business talks about what is left. So in that sense, if you look at it, the services sector by and large has been on a reddish trend because the, not only the coronavirus crisis, but the lockdown also affected demand for services. So if you see, there's a whole bunch of red, a little bit of greens are there. I'll take you through in detail in the next few slides. So services PMI has also shown a recovery, just touching the 50 level. Manufacturing is a little bit ahead, services is also following slowly, right? Air passenger traffic has now started slowly picking up, and wholesale loans to traders for our services has started sharply increasing. Trade loans have been increasing, right? And the services sector companies, if you already took a broad services index, that is those which don't fit into specific sub-segments, is not showing a great recovery in that last quarter, which is in line with the expectations. Financial services, which is part of services, we already discussed it when we discussed banking. And so there, if you see, the services sector, one-year return has now turned marginally positive, reflecting the improving performance. It's just showing a delta of 27% in the one-year returns, right? Retail is also shown an improvement from minus 5% to plus 2%. And another sector within the services is telecom and media. You know much in the news. And as you know from the telecom and media, the cell phone and subscriber base has been coming down, and the broadband subscription base has gone down. But these companies now operating in a duopoly are able to operate much better. And if you see the demand for media, because people are at home, the TV ads index has been showing a positive growth. And so if you look at the telecom, they have generally been able to enjoy good profitability, right? So if you see the telecom companies, they're having good operating profits and profit after tax. But media is naturally, because the cinemas are closed, the malls are closed, the media and entertainment business is naturally still not yet recovered. So overall, you'll see that telecom and media has been in a positive return territory because that monopoly, duopoly situation of the telecom has dominated this sector and shown the media part is dragging it, the telecom part is pushing it up, right? Miscellaneous sectors that are left are paper, textiles, miscellaneous are showing the deep impact of the economic slowdown. And hence, if you see, but there is a mix here, and here if you see that overall there are pockets of the economy where people are betting on the future. Hence, on a miscellaneous basis, you see that there is almost a delta of 54% from a deep negative to a double digit positive now, right? So it comes to Sundaram Mutual, how we are looking at sectors and all of this based on the analysis I've done, where we are overweight, that is bullish, is in these sectors where if you can see IT, pharma, financial services, telecom and media, chemicals and services. We discussed all of those in detail, and you can see all of their one-year returns are in positive territory. In the 1 month, telecom and media and this have shown a slight negative. Whereas, where are we in terms of neutral, where we are in a wait and watch situation? So 40% of the market, whereas the private banks, FMCG, automobiles, consumer discretionary, building materials, retail and capital goods, where we like to wait and watch the situation before we commit ourselves. So we are in a neutral vis-a-vis the benchmark, our weights are round about that period. Where are we underweight? We clearly negative as oil and gas sector, NBFC sector, infrastructure, utilities, ferrous, public sector banks, non-ferrous metals, as well as real estate are underweight, which is roughly 30% of the market. So based on that point of view, our overall portfolio, to summarize, I'll leave the slide on here. I will not read each line, but essentially captures what I've spoken about in the last few slides. So from a portfolio perspective, the right-hand side blob tells you our position. The downside protection is as important today as creating upsides from a sectoral perspective, right? And so now, to understand the large cap, mid cap and small cap breakups, you will understand that these sectoral performances of prices, stock prices, are reflecting in the indices performance. So you see, banks, which is not a great performing sector, is the largest weight there. So the large cap index is performing. Whereas if you go down to the mid cap, you see that the much less weightage of the banks, but pharma and consumer and auto ancillaries, which have been going up, are a much larger picture. So the mid cap segment's performance is reflected by the sectoral performance. The same is true of small cap, where pharma is now the highest weightage, followed by finance. So if you look at the sectoral breakup of the indices, it gives you a clue as to how they are performing and why they are performing so. So to finally, to sum up, right? Today, if you're an aggressive risk reward investor who's comfortable with sectoral funds, I would suggest the following way to break it up, but flexibility is the key. I.e., I would say what we see is that the safer, not so much linked to domestic economies, downturn, SIT, healthcare, and FMCG, I would say put half your money there. And then the developing sector, which is the banking and financial services, consumer durable, and auto, which are expected to recover a bit earlier, about 30%, and cyclicals and industrial, which are the high risk, high reward part, at the tail end, keep it at 20%. Maybe a year later, when the domestic V-shaped recovery is well formed, you can then reallocate it by increasing the weight on the cyclicals and the industrials and the banking and the consumer durable, and reducing it on the safer oriented sectors. Thank you for your patient listening. All the best. Please be safe.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.